Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Coast to coast, pole to pole, all around the world and the internet, thanks to the marvel of technology. I am coming at you live from my guest house in Memphis, Tennessee. You're listening to Keith Anthony Blanchard, and this is Center of Light Radio, Center of Divine Unfoldment and Reinforcement, radio for the soul. This week coming, probably Thursday, for those of you out there in the listening audience who have been dealing, struggling, trying to find your way through anxiety. I've seen a lot of posts on Facebook and social media about people currently just can't get through this black, thick stuff. I've lived it. I know exactly where you're coming from as to why I know the way through this dynamic. You can contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com, and just say, hey, I'm interested in that Anxiety No More Skype program that I'm going to be offering this week. Again, likely Thursday, and that's going to be 8 o'clock Eastern time. Send me an email. For all my YouTubers out there, go to Center of Light Radio on YouTube. You have access to all my past archive shows, and they're all phenomenal. I am very passionate about what I do and the guests that I get on this program. While you're there, subscribe. It helps Center of Light Radio's momentum to keep moving forward, to be around for a long time. Also, give me a thumbs up if there's an interview that you like. It helps me to gauge and refine my choices for future guests, and also leave me in a comment in that box just to say hello, and we can become face-to-face, so to speak, a little more personal. That's the way I roll. I love chatting and hanging out with people. Also, go to centeroflightradio.com and check out the brand new site. The opening page of that site, you're going to see a subscription form. Fill it out. Not only will you have access to my monthly Center of Light newsletter program, but you will also have access to a lot of powerful information that I do all the work. I follow the rabbit into the hole as far as possible on many different subjects. If there's something you want me to research for you, try me. I'll do it. Tell me something about a future guest, whatever genre or whatever field of spirituality or out of the box thinking of any sort. And I will do the research for you, and I will include that in a newsletter program. But also on the opening page, you will see a red Ferrari. Click it. It'll take you to my RPM program, recognize, plug in, and manifest your life. It's a year program that's once a month installments. And then this is not about fixing you. This is about helping you expand to greater degrees of bliss in your life, more abundance in your life, and all those wonderful attributes that we all aspire to. Tonight, I have a fantastic guest. His name is Alex Teplish. I'm going to do a couple more quick adverts, and we're going to get to Center of Light Radio business. Services. I do speaking engagements, have done it for years. You can contact me for themes about life-changing presentations of spirituality, divine incarnations, all different fields of spirituality or divine, but also about extraterrestrials, as you will hear about the show tonight. But my personal experiences and the knowledge that I have gleaned by hanging out with these others for many, many years in my life, ever since I was a boy, in fact. Spiritual readings, stay away from the word psychic, but let's look at it as if you need someone for a fresh pair of eyes and a fresh pair of ears that can help you move through some things that might be troubling you or blocking you from creating that next level in your life. Basically, in an hour, I guarantee you, that I can help you to get closer to explosive clarity. You have dark entities in your house, spiritual squatters, contact me. I will help you remove them from your home. This is a nuisance for you by giving you an arsenal of powerful information that will help elevate the vibration of you, your family, and your home. And I promise you, they will disappear. And I will not just hand you the information and split. I will be in it with you all the way until the goal of peace in your home is absolutely achieved. No word from my alien human hybrid friend, Nucleus 8. Still waiting. He's going to pop in one day, but we're going to have to make this a pre-recorded interview because we do not want his location to be targeted. And now it's time to get down to Center of Light Radio business. Today, my guest is Alex Teplish, and we will be discussing in the beginning Epic of the Anunnaki. Ancient legends, myths, and religions from around the world have spoken about gods and angels, not always in the spiritual sense, but actual flesh and blood beings interacting with mankind. Many of these ancient cultures had vast knowledge of mathematics and astronomy, attributing their knowledge as being handed down from the gods. Who were these godlike beings known to one of the oldest civilizations, the Sumerians, as the Anunnaki? This two-part story starts with an amazing discovery in the present day that takes us back hundreds of thousands of years. Follow the Anunnaki on their ancient astronaut journey from Nibiru to Earth and their interactions with humanity's genesis. You can find more about my guest in his phenomenal book at www.inthebeginningthebook.com. Welcome to Center of Light Radio, Mr. Alex Teplish.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Brother, I just don't know how to start this thing. You just say, flat out, what is your affinity for the Anunnaki? I mean, a lot of people are into the alien stuff, and they dabble in a lot of different fields, and I'm sure you probably as well. But why the Anunnaki for you? Do you feel that there is some connection? Well, obviously there is, because you wrote a book about it, and your life's work is surrounding this. But do you have a connection on some other level, maybe a past life, or just connected now? How did this all start for you, sir?
Well, I guess it started back in childhood. I attended a Jewish school for several years where they taught us some of the more primitive or like the more childish biblical teachings of the book of Genesis. And that really got me questioning the whole thing. What really happened? Because my family wasn't really observant or religious in the sense, but we still, I attended this school because we were immigrants in the United States and they were pro here. And I really was interested in what was the truth behind all of this. So I started to think about it throughout my life and really investigate all types of ancient civilizations. And it eventually led me to the topic of extraterrestrials. There are many nonfiction books. One of them is one famous author, Zechariah Sitchin, who is the one who initially got me inspired into the topic, put together all these theories connecting the Anunnaki and the Bible, as known to the Jews, the Christians, and the Muslims, or at least the Old Testament, and connected it to this even more ancient civilization and their teachings and their beliefs.
My familiarity with the subject of Anunnaki has come through Zechariah Sitchin's work. The Book of Enki, it's just amazing to me. For the listening audience out there, can you shed some light on the idea how Zechariah Sitchin came up with all this by putting together these tablets?
Right. So he started looking into the parallels in the ancient Sumerian writings, which were recorded in cuneiform on clay tablets. The Sumerians were the first civilization that we've discovered to this day that had an advanced civilization. They had the first form of actual writing, advanced mathematics, astronomy. They were the ones who invented the wheel and many other things that we still use to this day. Down to their numerical system, which we use for counting time and degrees and things like that. So they were really the first. And in their writings, they wrote that much of their knowledge was handed down to them by the gods. They referred to the gods as the Anunnaki. And they had unique names for each of them. Not only did they have unique names, but these gods had city-states that they ruled, or the city-states that worshipped individual gods or knew about other gods, but had a god that they were ultimately responsible to. And that whole belief system in their writings, they had a lot of parallels, or many parallels, to the Book of Genesis and the Old Testament. So it led researchers, including Zechariah Sitchin, but many before him and before the extraterrestrial topic came into being, that really said that many of these writings in the Bible are derived from the ancient Sumerian texts.
Since this show and your book is titled In the Beginning, let's go to the beginning. Wasn't this civilization, there was a king that supposedly had two sons who they were looking to mine gold from Earth? Tell me a little bit more about that beginning of how they begin to work their way towards us.
This is the theory by Zechariah Sitchin, is that the Anunnaki inhabited a planet called Nibiru within our own solar system, which is too distant for us to detect at the moment. Although we have had many breakthroughs in detecting a large planet or multiple planets in the distant beyond the Oort cloud, beyond the asteroid belt, and beyond all our known planets within our own solar system. So recently they've been talking about this, and that could be the ultimate planet where the Anunnaki come from. So that was part of the theory. And the theory is that they circle our sun. It takes thousands of years, according to Zechariah Sitchin. He recorded that it takes 3,600 years for it to complete one orbit around the sun, as opposed to Earth. So that is the point why we wouldn't know about it in so many thousands of years, or we wouldn't have heard about it or experienced it. At the same time, the Anunnaki were the ones who came from this planet, and they were facing calamities within their own environment. And this, again, this is the theory, that they realized that they would be able to use gold, break it down to its smallest particles, and suspend it into their atmosphere, which would then help sustain their atmosphere and help them live longer on their own planet. Mm. There are other theories that they used gold for other purposes, like longevity, or basically improving their health by breaking it down to monatomic gold. And there's some people who, in that camp, who believe that. The parallel to that is in the book of Genesis. There's a quote that it says, "And a river flowed out of Eden to water the garden, and from there it separated and became four heads. The name of one is Pishon, that is one that encompasses the land of Havilah, where there is gold." So in this passage of Book of Genesis, why is it so important to point out that gold was located in the area? This is when just Adam and Eve were being created, and already there's talk of gold. So that's just one small parallel. And if you look around, all the ancient civilizations have venerated gold throughout history and have accumulated it and hoarded it. And it's been basically passed on to the upper echelons of each civilization.
Yeah, that seems a little soon to be talking about gold when things haven't really gotten off the ground yet.
Right. We're talking about the creation of man, and the Bible writers are already talking about gold. Why is it so important?
And so this king supposedly ruled for 9 shads, is that right? And a shad is equivalent to our year, but theirs takes thousands of years, and he ruled for 9, is that right, if I remember correctly?
Right. Well, you're talking about the king Anu.
Yes.
I believe that's what you're talking about. And he was believed to be, or by the Sumerians, the original king of the Anunnaki. He was their ruler, and he had 2 sons, or he had multiple children, but 2 of his main sons were Enki and Enlil, and they had some sibling rivalry, if you want to call it that, to eventually become the ruler. Enki was originally sent to Earth to create and develop the land. Enlil eventually joined him. And when their other gods, the minor gods, who they refer to in their writings, began to work on the land, and part of the theory is that they were mining for gold as well, they started to complain, and they started to complain that the work was too hard. And this is not all part of the theory. Big portion of what I'm saying here is in the Sumerian writings itself. The gods were complaining of their toil, and Enki came up with the plan to create a worker man. And that is when they discussed creating a form of humans prior to us, and eventually upgraded it to the point where they created us, modern humans.
I want to ask you about the hype that we see often in social media. Nibiru is coming. You being the expert, and I say expert with all due respect, and the fact that you're passionate about this field, that you've done the work, you've done the research. What are your thoughts about the fact that we see these posts and these news bulletins about the fact that this is going to become close to our proximity sometime soon? Do you think, is this just hogwash in your opinion?
Well, I think that with any sensational topic, and this is definitely a sensational topic, because yes, if you ask every other person, most people in the street, they've never heard of the ancient astronaut theory, they've never heard of the Anunnaki, and they probably have never even heard of the Sumerian civilization, even though Sumerian civilization has been studied for hundreds of years at this point. So the sensationalism of this topic is then taken a stretch further by those who create extreme blogs or tabloid newspapers or anything like that. And they try to sensationalize it further by scaring people, by working on people's fear, telling people that Nibiru is coming to crash into Earth, when in fact the theory was that Nibiru or some other object connected to Nibiru crashed into the primitive Earth, which was in a different orbit, 4 billion years ago. So at that point, it pushed the new object into this new orbit and created Earth and the Moon, and it's now not in the way of Nibiru. But whenever Nibiru does pass, and not every single time, because there obviously isn't a major worldwide calamity every 3,600 years, whenever this object or planet does pass, there is a chance of some kind of worldwide or natural disasters. For example, floods, meteors, things like that. And that stems from the big great flood story, the deluge.
I don't want to stay on talking about Zachariah Sitchin, even though that is the only reference I have about this particular subject and about this particular race of people and their relationship to humanity. So forgive me, because I want to make this about you and your work. So if I keep referring back to it again, that's only my knowledge of it. But that being said, in your work, your research, in your intuition, Alex, have you come upon some new findings that may not be discovered through exploring Zachariah Sitchin's work?
Yeah, actually, I found several comparisons and similarities to other ancient civilizations and things they've discussed. So, for example, there's the Sumerian civilization, which we just discussed, and they describe a king's list. They have an object. It's currently in the museum. An object that describes a king's list going back an age prior to the Great Flood, where gods and demigods ruled and lived for thousands of years, some living tens of thousands of years. So this knowledge was given to the Sumerians. The Sumerians possessed advanced knowledge, like I said, in writing, mathematics, astronomy, and they describe kingship being handed down from the gods. They also mention how the gods created mankind as workers, and the god Enki warned Zeusudra, who is another name for Noah, to build a large boat to survive the Great Flood. So that's the Sumerian portion of it. The parallel in the Vedic civilization, which is the ancient Indian civilization, so they describe different ages based on a period of revolution of the sun around the dark companion, which could be this other either object or the failed star or even another smaller star that we haven't detected, with humanity currently in the fourth age called the Kali Yuga. So we're about to enter the fifth age. In the previous Yuga, which is what they call their cycles, normal human stature was taller, and the average human lifespan was 1,000 or years, with even longer lifespans in their prior age. So this is a direct parallel between the Vedic civilization and Sumerians. They talk about this cycle on Earth, the destruction by the flood, and the stature and the lifespans of the previous civilization. And humans interacting with gods, that's also part of the Vedic civilization, many gods with different names and different characteristics. And like I said, they also have a great flood ending at the last yuga.
So from my reading of the little bit that I've done in the Bhagavad Gita about their contact with extraterrestrials and that there was a war, what you're referring to, is this at the same period, the time when Krishna was about?
Right. They have a description where
it's
very much like a nuclear type war. They describe the cloud that goes up into the sky, the devastation that happened around, the types of death and destruction that took place from this war, this weapon. They call it the ultimate weapon. It definitely sounds like advanced weaponry, something that the ancient civilizations weren't supposed to have.
I don't know this to be true, but I was told or remember somehow that Krishna being considered God, who was on Earth at that time, that somehow humanity lost that fight.
Right. Well,
in quotes.
They, the, the, They actually had humanity on various sides of the fight. It wasn't necessarily a god versus
I see.
It was gods versus gods. So they were having their own wars on Earth or within the vicinity of Earth and utilizing humans, not just as workers, but as soldiers, fighting each other. Kind of like what the powerful governments do this today with proxy wars. And
it hasn't changed.
Third world countries.
Would you give us some idea, please, not only Zachariah Sitchin, but your work as well, how this begins to parallel and mesh a lot of with the Bible? And we don't have to stay on this topic long, but a lot of people come because they're curious. And a lot of these people are local to me. I live in the Bible Belt. No judgment, of course. It's just a fact of the matter. But they may have a hunger, a curiosity. Can you give us some information about how some of these events, we talked about Adam and Eve, you talked about the flood a few times, we mentioned it, but we never really went into that other than the fact that this man who had another name, we know as Noah, began to build this ark. What was the ark? How were these two upon two creatures taken on this craft or and off of the earth and other events that might parallel with the Bible from the Anunnaki story?
Right. Well, the Noah story, I think, is basically an exaggerated version of what actually happened. There is evidence, and the Sumerians wrote about it, and there are actually over 200 different flood myths around the world. So I think that these survivors came out of many civilizations, or the story actually got around the world and many people knew about it. And that's why all these civilizations have a similar flood myth. Other parallels are the Tower of Babel. They talk about there are similarities to Cain and Abel and the Adam and Eve. Adam is described as Adapa by the Sumerians. So there are many parallels. And when I talk about religions or these religions in general, I'm not trying to say that there's no value to it. I think that there is value, and there are people who take allegories from their religions and try to do good in the world, and that's great. Or build a community and work together and get along, and that's really what it should be about. And I think that it's been a combination of humanity searching for the truth to their origins, having this spiritual yearning, but at the same time, misunderstanding and confusing what actually took place in our ancient past. And these stories over thousands of years being passed down, they kind of started to lose their meaning. And spiritual advisors, spiritual teachers started to convert them and turn them into these allegories. And I think that that's really what the modern day Bible is really become.
Is Cain and Abel the metaphorical Enlil and Enki?
They could be, but I believe that there was also a human parallel and humans on Earth who were trying to work for the Anunnaki and serve them and competing with one another. So in my book, I actually try to recreate this book in the beginning, The Epic of the Anunnaki, is a graphic novel recreation of the book of Genesis. So I take some of these parallels and some of these stories, and I put them into I portray them from the extraterrestrial perspective, from the Anunnaki perspective.
Well, you had mentioned a little earlier that they have not only individual names, but they have different names. What would be the difference between the Sumerians and the Anunnaki?
So the Sumerians are the people, the humans, that lived in modern day Iraq, thousands of years ago, 5,000-6,000 years ago, and they were the first ones to have writing that we have deciphered. They actually just released a dictionary that took many, many years to put together. It's out there, the dictionary in physical form costs thousands of dollars, but you could download it for free. I have a post on my Facebook page about it. I actually recently downloaded and started studying it as well. So the Sumerians were the ones who recorded all of this. And they talk about the Anunnaki, which were their gods, or we call them gods, but they call them lords, or they're basically the rulers of their kings. They were the ones who the kings responding to and responsible to. So that's the difference, really. The Sumerians were humans, and the Anunnaki were these gods, or as part of the theory, would consider them extraterrestrials that are very similar to humans.
I'm sitting here thinking about the Book of Enki and then your role, what you're doing. And the question I asked you earlier, I don't know if we got sidetracked, but do you feel somehow connected to this star system, these beings, this planet, this whole movement, this whole idea of the Anunnaki. Did you feel like pushed, prompted, or do you think you just had an affinity about the story of the Anunnaki to write such things? Because I don't remember the scribe, I guess you could say, that was taken off of the planet and brought to this place and had this tool that cut into stone like melted butter. But does you feel some connection to that story as far as in that way of being a writer to tell about it?
First of all, the Book of Enki is a translation by Zechariah Sitchin of the tablets with a little bit of his own injection trying to fill in the blanks of the story of the Anunnaki from Enki's perspective. So it's almost like a diary from Enki's perspective. That's kind of what my graphic novel is, except it's a visualization of that story. I can't say I've always had an affinity for or a deep yearning for the Anunnaki, because I didn't discover them until my adult life. But throughout my life, I always felt that there were many deeper truths that we haven't yet discovered, that I didn't know about and I wanted to pursue, stemming from religion, but also being inspired by science fiction, by comic books, and just by fantasy and the movies that are out there. I was a big fan of Star Wars and Star Trek as a child, and the ideas that the authors put together on those pages and in those movies really got me thinking about what's out there and what's the truth behind our ancient origins.
Dig it for sure. Why do we love that stuff so much? What kind of chord is it resonating within us? Is it a memory? Is it a longing? Okay, right. So let me ask you, Alex, if you don't mind, do you still have any nighttime excursions with others?
I can't say I've had any nighttime excursion with others. I haven't been that lucky to have that type of experience.
I'm not so sure luck would be the word to use across the board.
True.
But at least with me, I can tell, I will be a witness that at least every one of the experiences I've ever had, ever, in the sense that I would wake up knowing I had a hyper, super conscious experience with others, has always been of the positive. I was never taken beyond my free will. I was never violated ever. I must have been a good boy in many previous lives or made up contracts saying, this is where I'm willing to go and this is where the door will be shut. Alex, we're at the bottom of the hour. Would you give out your contact information and anything you would like to share with our listening audience about you and your work, sir?
Sure. So if anybody's interested in the book, I think you mentioned earlier, it's www.inthebeginningthebook.com. That's where the book can be purchased. There's a little small gallery there. But if you want to go beyond that, and there's a lot of content on my Facebook page, which is very active, it's facebook.com/inthebeginningthebook. I do a lot of research on ancient civilizations, astronomy, the connection between the two, megalithic sites, ancient mysterious sites, and bring it all together, connecting it to the ancient astronaut theory. Now, one thing I wanted to mention is that I don't consider myself a believer, and I put that in quotes, of the ancient astronaut theory, because that word really is more of a religious word. It's more about believing something and having faith in it, whether you have proof or not, or whether the proof is valid or not. And I personally don't like using that word when it comes to this topic. I find the theory is very plausible, and the more I research it, the more connections I find and the more mysteries that I open. So I think that it's something that's one of our biggest mysteries in the world and to humanity. And that's why I choose to continuously pursue it and research it. And I encourage everyone to do that, and don't take anyone's word for it. Don't just believe what someone hands to you. There's a lot of sensational articles out there. And I try to stay away from that. I try to find actual similarities to ancient civilizations, try and find parallels with the ancient writings, and then find matching and corresponding theories and scientific facts that we're still discovering to this day.
Keith Anthony Blanchard here, Center of Light Radio, to remind you about my lifelong work, RPM, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. Let me ask you a few questions. What is it you want out of your life? You want more financial stability? You want relationship? You want greater degrees of bliss, conscious expansion, and spiritual evolvement? These are magnificent, wonderful things, and I have achieved all of these by implementing what I am offering to you so you can apply this to your life so you can have all those things that you truly desire and truly deserve. I absolutely guarantee my work 100%. Go to Center of Light Radio. Look at the opening page, the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Not only will you receive my awesome Power Pack newsletter monthly, but you will have access to my RPM program. Stay in touch with me, and I will send you everything I'm about, all my successful works. You can bet. All you have to do is contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Peace, love, and light to you always. Why should we care, to use the word, with no disrespect, why should we know more about the Anunnaki story? How does that relate to us today, and what can we use in a situation of application that can actually better us?
Well, I think that just for me, at least, when I started researching this topic, it really opened up a lot of other knowledge that came along with it. Knowledge on astronomy, knowledge on ancient civilizations and the way they lived, evolution, sociology, everything really, how humanity is connected to this day, what connections we have in the ancient past, genetics. And I think that the more you research it, the more you realize that we're not that much different from one another. And that the ultimate goal is for us to be unified once again, which we all stem from the same root. And I think that's really the ultimate point of everything, of learning in general, is that we're all the same and we're all seeking the truth. We have different backgrounds. We've made different mistakes in our lives, but we're all headed in the same direction. And as long as we're passionate and compassionate to one another, then we'll eventually get there.
Have they come back, meaning in a revealing our presence in the night skies kind of way? Are they here, particularly the Anunnaki? And are they coming back in the way that I'm asking the question of, are they coming back to say, hey, you know, we were your ancestors and we're responsible for doing this? Is there going to be some sort of disclosure and our connection with them would be revealed from your findings?
Well, disclosure would be great. I've actually had some comical posts on that, showing President Obama and eventually President Trump, where they kind of have a conversation about it or disclosing it, but it's all in fun. At the same time, I'm not really sure that our world leaders or our governments at a lower level are all aware of this. I think that there's a deeper level of people in charge. And the ones who actually know the truth, don't share it with everyone in government. And the president, somebody who comes in and out, but there are others who stay around for a much longer time. And they may report to even higher ups that rule from the shadows that really most people wouldn't know or have never heard of. In my book, I do theorize that most of the Anunnaki left the Earth when they had their window of opportunity. Their technology for space flight is not that much further than ours, so they can travel and they can do things a little bit better than we've been able to do, but not interstellar flight, or at least not back then. So they only have a small window of opportunity when they can come to Earth or leave Earth. And in my book, I do theorize that they left at some point, but some did stay behind, and those may be the ones who are running the world governments and the world situation to this day. And also the reason why we still hoard gold and value it to such a degree.
Ah, that makes a lot of sense. So let me ask you this. I mentioned cosmic disclosure, and you went on to describe what you did. It seems to me, out of my passion for, and I've been watching, you know, the Gaia TV series, the cosmic disclosure, just putting more information in my brain, keeping that open file. I don't know anything, right? Mm-hmm. And so, but I never really hear about the Anunnaki in the sense that they're extraterrestrials, meaning we hear about the Greys, we hear about the Draconians, and we hear about the Pleiadians, and we hear about all these people, all these different crafts and beings that come here to Earth to say hi and to show off their technology. And we see them in the night skies. We always get these labels of these particular races of beings. But I, to be honest with you, Alex, I've never heard of some people saying that was the Anunnaki, or I've never really heard that. So why are they so invisible, or why haven't I heard about them making an appearance? It sounds like they, you know, gazillions and trillions of light years away, and they're just staying there for now. It's like they're not coming at all. Or am I mistaken?
Right. Well, the calculations that were done based on ancient history and biblical history and the years would put them at a point where they don't have the opportunity to come here based on their own technology. They're basically dormant until a certain window of opportunity comes about.
So did they devolve?
No, they just weren't able to travel back and forth on a regular basis.
Ah, gotcha.
And, and there could be these other extraterrestrials, and I do touch on that subject slightly in my book, that maybe even more advanced than them, and they took over, and they've been coming here as well. And perhaps some of these ancient wars were between the two, the Anunnaki and another race of extraterrestrials. And putting these extraterrestrials in a more advanced state may have led them to be able to take over after the Anunnaki created humanity.
So is the Anunnaki civilization or the planet of Nibiru, would this be more of a malevolent or benevolent civilization? At least the one that we're speaking of about the past, we don't know currently because that information is we haven't received it yet. But were they mostly cool people or were they, you know, knuckleheads?
I think that they're a lot like us, or we're actually a lot like them. The way that the Anunnaki are described by the Sumerians, they describe them very human-like. They drank beer. They had sexual encounters. They had their own factions. They had their own disagreements and conflicts, theft. So I think that there's not one unified faction of the Anunnaki, and some may have an admiration for humans while others may not. So it's hard to say whether they're malevolent or not. But I would say that since they didn't destroy us, or they allowed us to continue our own civilization, and since they did hand down a lot of the knowledge to humanity, that for the most part, they're like us. They want good for most people, and it doesn't always work out that way.
You know, it makes sense to me that regardless of the civilizations, we might deem a particular race or civilization as bad beings, but you can bet probably on their own home planet that those people who are that way are always in the seat of power, and that the other aspect of the civilizations are people who are just trying to make their way to live out a decent life with their family unit.
Yep, definitely. I mean, unless they've evolved to a point where they're so far off from humans that it's not even something we can compare to.
Couldn't even grasp their reality.
Right, right. But if anything that's close to humanity, I think that they would have their own factions. They have their own opinions. And just like we do today, we have so many divisions, so many different opinions and sides to a topic. And unfortunately, that divides us as humans, but it shouldn't be that way. It shouldn't be one group versus another. It should be more about, okay, we disagree on this issue, but we agree on another issue.
Alex, we had someone in the chat room, Neutron. He asked a question. He said he went to your site and he's looking for the link to the Sumerian dictionary download. Can you send me some information, or can you pinpoint exactly where that's at with the URL?
Yeah, so it's actually not on my website. It's on the Facebook page. facebook.com/inthebeginningthebook. And it's probably like 4, 5, or 6 posts down. If you just scroll through, you'll see there's a post I made about the Akkadian dictionary. They don't call it Sumerian. It was basically the Sumerian, Akkadian, there are many interchangeable words where city-states are combining in different civilizations at the same time, but they all had one similar language, and that's what was combined and created into a dictionary recently.
Good luck on finding that, Neutron, and thank you, brother, for the info and the question. Alex, from your findings, have the Anunnaki achieved an ascended state compared to maybe what we would see ourselves technological-wise now? But as far as spiritual expansion, have you found anything to tell that they are expanding, they're achieving different levels of consciousness, or that there was a consciousness explosion, anything like that at all?
In my book, I actually theorized that part of the reason they left, or what they left to, was a spiritual evolution on their own planet and a next level of expansion, just like you mentioned. So that could be another reason why they haven't come back, or they may never come back, or at least the ones that left may not come back. And the ones that are still here haven't evolved like those because they didn't leave with them. So my theory is that they may have realized or come up with a technology beyond what we are aware of that puts them into another dimension and brings them to this next level of consciousness, where they may or may not inhabit their current bodies, or they may be on another level of consciousness while their body remains alive.
Tell me some more about your work. We spent some time about Zachariah Sitchin, because that is kind of the foundation of the base that of my knowledge, as well as what you continue to take forward with the baton. Tell me some more about your work so our listening audience can be motivated to dive into your pages, sir.
Right. So I try not to use Zechariah Sitchin as my one and only source, because it's if you always go back to the same source, it doesn't really prove much. You need to have multiple sources, multiple researchers. So I look for other translations of the Sumerian texts. There are online sources. There's an online ancient encyclopedia that you can search through with different keywords. There are other writers that touch on the ancient astronaut theory. So I try to investigate the subject from many different angles. At the same time, I find comparisons and similarities between ancient civilizations. I mentioned the Vedics. I mentioned the Sumerians. There are also comparisons with the Mayans, as well as the Hopis in the United States. So those are the types of things I look for. I also travel. I try to travel to ancient sites and learn as much as I can on location. Go to the museums of those countries that have those artifacts. I recently traveled to Mexico and visited some of the Mayan sites like Tulum and Coba. I have posts on my page about that. I have actually very extensive albums of the photos and videos that I've taken at these sites. I also traveled to Costa Rica about a little less than a year ago, where I visited a few ancient sites there, and they had interactions with other civilizations around the Yucatan. So that's part of what I like to do, in addition to researching. But the reason I chose to put this together as a graphic novel is really to visualize the story, to put it into a storyline, take the theory, put it into a storyline, and then visualize how it may have taken place, give people an easier outlet to really get a summary of the whole theory, to really get them inspired to want to delve deeper into the topic. And then I encourage people to read the books, research yourself, come to your own conclusions. So that's really what it is. And the ultimate goal of this project is to, and that's what I'm working towards right now, I'm getting very close to it, is to create either a standalone film or a film followed by a series on this subject, starting with an adaptation of my graphic novel and then touching on all the other interactions with ancient civilizations. So that's really the ultimate goal, and I hope to reach it very soon.
Brother, my intuition says you will achieve that goal. So congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. You read my mind. I was going to ask you, and you're definitely a globetrotter for sure. I saw your social media page. When you travel about and you go to these sites personally, I was going to ask you, have you ever had the chance to go where they found the scrolls, the tablets? I know the world is kind of chaotic right now. Have you been to that particular location?
No, I haven't. I mean, I would love to go.
Yeah, right.
These places are mostly in Iraq, the Middle East, and unfortunately, the places where they find the most interesting sites are the places in the world that have the most chaos going on right now, and the most war and the most terror. In fact, ISIS is demolishing some of these ancient artifacts before we even get to study them in detail, unfortunately.
Yeah, do we think that's a coincidence that all these hot zones are happening around? God knows what kind of energy is being pushed forth from the earth in these locations from such ancient, powerful technology.
Right. And who knows? Maybe there's the reason why the conflict is there and why people aren't getting to go and travel and investigate these things further. In fact, a big portion, I would say, they recently discovered that there are over 40,000 different sites in Iraq and the surrounding areas, tracing back to the Sumerians and some of the civilizations that side by side live side by side with them. And over 50%, possibly over 80%, aren't even excavated. So there's still so much to be found, so much to be translated. And unfortunately, people can't do it. The archaeologists can't go there. There's very limited study. They're just trying to keep it alive and keep it preserved at this point.
Yeah, it makes sense. So, Alex, where are we going next with you and your work? Other than the fact that you are trying to make this into some sort of film experience, what do we see coming down? Are you going to write a second novel? Or can there be a second novel? Because the story does end as far as we know it, yes?
Well, I did create the first book in the beginning, The Epic of the Anunnaki, as a standalone story. But I left a lot of things open at the end. It does retell the book of Genesis, but it doesn't really go deep into the subject of the Sumerian civilization, the Vedic civilization, and so on. So I definitely see myself eventually creating sequels to this book, more than one, either in graphic novel form or as a TV series, to explore those other interactions and all these deeper stories that took place. And throughout, I want to weave in the spiritual aspects as well, so that it's not just cold and dry, but bring some humanity to the subject and deeper than that. But try to define what, you know, the meaning of life and what the deeper things of all civilizations beyond Earth may have in common.
I can definitely appreciate that. Would you give our listening audience a tidbit of information about how the flood that we know from biblical times could coincide with the flooding that happened with the Anunnaki, as far as how were the creatures removed from Earth versus the wooden boat?
The flood may have happened because Nibiru at the time was affecting certain objects in space to eventually crash into the Earth. And there is evidence that during the last ice age, there was a warming period and another cold freezing period caused by these meteorites. And eventually, when the ice age ended, many of the areas began to flood. The water level began to rise globally. It may have not all happened in a day, like the Bible describes. It may have not all happened in the same place at the same time, but gradually around the world, the water levels began to rise. Many ancient cities that were on the coasts of those countries began to flood. They're finding more and more of these underwater cities every day. And that's really the connection. That's the connection between the flood. And the Anunnaki had compassion, or at least some of them did, and they wanted to save the humans that they felt closest to. So they helped the biblical character Noah. He's also known as Utnapishtim or Ziusudra in different languages, different civilizations.
Didn't they supposedly take creatures off of the earth, not per se in a wooden ship, but in a light ship by taking the DNA versus having these actual creatures on board? That story, I mean, I understand the allegory and the parallel. It just doesn't make sense to me. But then they supposedly, in your findings, did they take these creatures off by DNA?
I haven't encountered that type of information, but it's definitely possible. I did encounter information in the Sumerian writings where during the flood, the gods retreat into the heavens and they actually weep for the humans, and this is written by the Sumerians. They write the heavens. They don't necessarily use the word space like we do, but that was the word that they used at the time. And one example is the character of Enoch, which is part of the Apocrypha, but he's also in the Old Testament. He is the great-grandfather of Noah, and in the Bible they talk about the angels taking him and teaching him all this knowledge, or in the Apocrypha, actually, which is an extension of the Bible, which was banned by the early church leaders as part of the biblical texts. They describe Enoch, from his own words, being taken up to the heavens and describing the land getting smaller and smaller, and even bringing up the calculations of the orbit around the sun down to a decimal point, talking about the planetary motions, things that were in this apocryphal book. And they're also found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. So they found copies of it in the Dead Sea Scrolls.
In one of my dreamscapes, Alex, I met Enoch, came to a state of full-blown consciousness, as conscious as I am talking into this microphone, if not more so. And when I came to a state of awareness and got my center, though I didn't look to my right, there was a guy to my right, and I could see him, her, peripherally. And they said, Keith, you've been a good participant all these years. Today is your graduation. And for that, your award is to meet the people in charge. And a being comes out of the door on the right, 5 foot, let's say 5 foot seven, very feminine in appearance. It was dressed in all earth tones. It had headdress. And I met the person and I could feel the power. I can feel the authority coming from this being. And then my guide next to me said, now I want you to meet the absolute head honcho, so to speak. And a being came out of the door on the left and they looked exactly, I mean, they were identical in every possible way. But the power charge was so different between the leader and second in command. It was just extremely powerful, completely different. And the being was introduced to me as Enoch from the days of yore, as it was told to me.
Very interesting.
I love these nighttime escapades, these gallivants around the universe. I have a lot of fun. And I'm surprised that someone with your passion and doing what you do on this subject hasn't really, at least yet, or consciously, had these particular recalls.
You know, as I was working on the actual graphic novel and reading the texts, I felt like the actual story was coming to me in my mind, you know, whether it's creativity or, you know, I don't like to use the word channeling necessarily because I did not, you know, there's a fine line between creativity and actually channeling. I try to stick to the theory. I try to connect every part of the story or most parts of the story to the ancient texts. But at the same time, I had to fill in the conversations, the characters, and the storyline to make it flow. So some of it came to me, you know, it came from the ether, the universal consciousness, some people call it.
Do you have any other works? You have this phenomenal book that you can bet I'm going to dig into. Do you have anything else that you can share with our listening audience that you have? Any other books, any other pieces of your passion?
Yeah, so another book that I recently completed on a completely different subject is a book. It's a hybrid graphic novel and history book. And the first portion, which is the graphic novel, depicts my grandfather growing up in the former Soviet Union and surviving during World War II and throughout the Holocaust. So I basically took, translated his memoirs. He actually gave an interview to the Shoah Foundation, founded by Steven Spielberg. So I have 3 hours of footage of him speaking about his experiences, in addition to all the stories he told me throughout my childhood. And I put them into another graphic novel storyline, completely factual. Everything is the way he tells it or connected to a poor part of history. And I tell the whole story from beginning to end of our family, of where we came from, and then how we ended up in the United States. And then the second part of that book is the historical context of the Jewish diaspora, how the Jews ended up all over the world, how they ended up in Europe and Ukraine and the former USSR, what led to the two world wars, what led to the rise of the Nazi Party, the Holocaust, and what happened afterwards. I try to define all of that and answer a lot of questions.
Alex, we are at the top of the hour. Would you give out your contact information once again, please? And would you also leave us with a final thought?
Sure. So for the book I just described, that is called Survivor Aaron's Story. And that's the website, www.survivoraaronstory.com. The book we've been talking about on this interview and the subject was In the Beginning, The Epic of the Anunnaki. And the website is inthebeginningthebook.com. And the Facebook is facebook.com/inthebeginningthebook. One thought, I would just encourage everyone to research, think for yourself. Don't fall for all the tabloid and sensationalism out there. Keep reading deeper. Try to find multiple sources for what you're looking for. Keep searching for the truth, and be good to your fellow neighbor. Be good to everyone, and work together instead of apart.
Couldn't have said it better myself. What a most enjoyable guest you were, sir. Thank you for being a wonderful presence here at Center of Light Radio.
Thank you so much.
Keep me posting what you're doing. I would love to have you come back.
Yep, definitely. We'll keep in touch.
Alex, be well, sir. Everyone, Mr. Alex Teplish. What a phenomenal guest. I really enjoyed this guy. Very well spoken. Love his passion. That's for sure. I connect to passion. When you be passionate about whatever it is, you know, if you're going to be angry, damn it, be passionately angry and you'll command my attention. That's a fact. I love seeing people connect to the fire in the belly. Next week on Center of Light Radio, Heather Sartain is going to be here. She's from Cosmic Disclosure, the series on Gaia, which is making a lot of noise. And I do respect Mr. Alex Teplish's stance on sensationalism. I think this somehow, it may have some of that, but I think it's a little different. I've marathon watched all of the seasons in a matter of a couple of weeks. Now I'm current. Heather Sartain made two appearances on Cosmic Disclosure. She's going to be here talking about the pineal gland called One Small Step Toward a Giant Leap of Mind. She's also going to be telling us about how her father worked for NASA and told her some pretty amazing things when she was a teenager. In fact, he didn't know she was eavesdropping. And when she got older, he began to tell a lot of things about what's happening on the dark side of the moon with all of these civilizations, 22 supposedly alien civilizations that's been there since before World War One that the Germans were the first in space, blah, blah, blah. But we're going to let her tell all of that juicy stuff next Monday night. And the following week, Neil Donald Walsh's daughter is going to be here. Neil Donald Walsh, famed for Conversations with God. Tara Janelle Walsh is going to be here. My name is Keith Anthony Blanchard. Go to sumerianlightradio.com. Click on that red Ferrari. Get plugged into the R.P.M. program. Also, remember to go to YouTube, Center of Light Radio on YouTube, and subscribe to my channel. Give me some thumbs up on some of the interviews you like. Leave me a comment just to say hi, and I will respond back to you. Always remember, I am here. And one final thought, if you want to join this Anxiety No More program this week, contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Be well, take care of yourself and each other. Peace, love, and light to you. Good evening.